actually record the meeting as well. So, and I'll distribute. I don't know where it'll get posted, but it'll be up on one of the websites.
Fabulous. Yeah.
So I tried this today and it worked. So I'm just going to let it run in the background. So let's get everyone here. I'm sorry, Teresa, your last name?
Wiggins, W-I-G-G-I-N-S.
Is it with an H?
T-H-E-R. Yeah.
Actually,
yes.
let me put that down as an audience member. And then... One L or two L, Linda?
Phillips. Two.
All right. It's a small enough group where it doesn't. And again, there's no pride of authorship here. I thought one way to get going was maybe just describe a desired outcome of the group. We're here for a reason. I thought just very simply was to try to get a proclamation that the Board of Selectmen, the subgroup, council and manager could agree with.
So I think that is maybe something that we had different takeaways from the last meeting on, it sounds like.
Okay.
So I think our desired outcome for today is to, one, share with you a little bit more of our background. And I
Absolutely.
Know that
I want to do introductions and all that. But
okay.
Just
so I know that
setting.
We did
and also
go over that.
How all this kind of...
Background, which we did talk about, but I feel like the message got a little bit lost in the last meeting where, you know, our agenda item was up, and I think Bob recommended sort of his approach at it, and I don't know that we ever really got to dig into the background. I feel like We talked about it, but it kind of went down a rabbit hole.
Why don't we try to start over and just back up with just introductions? And we'll take
idea.
It from there.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sorry to say, other than Barry and the Phillips from town meeting, I haven't had the pleasure to meet you ladies. I've been in Reading for 34 years, three kids, one wife, multiple animals, three kids through Reading schools, finance committee, town meeting member, board of selectmen. Very simply.
And I'm Gina McCormick. I grew up in Melrose, actually lived there for 20-some years, moved to Wakefield and Brookline, and then I moved to D.C. for a dozen years, went to law school there and stayed for
Did you work
many
in government?
Years.
Did you work in government?
No, I worked, I represented foster kids in the district committed to So kids with special needs.
Yeah, you guys are welcome to move up.
Yeah, it's just so I can hear better, too. Here, hon, do you want to sit here?
Sure.
And then moved into recruiting, and when we had our second daughter, decided we needed to be back near the family. My husband also went to law school in D.C., and I convinced him to move up here right before the snowiest winter in the history of Boston, so that was awesome. And I've been here since 2014. Or back, you know, the backup.
Yeah, back in the Northeast.
Yep.
Teresa?
So I'm Teresa. I grew up in Bedford, a couple towns over, and am a teacher. And I taught third, fourth, fifth, and sixth.
Are you here? Teacher here?
No, I taught in Natick for 4 years and then in Bedford, my hometown, for 10 years. And then my husband and I moved here 8 years ago from Waltham, and now I'm a business owner. Still have my teaching credentials, but I work with families and I work with schools on family engagement, engaging effectively, and behavior management, and I teach mindfulness. It's called Village Parenting.
So you're almost an intermediary between families and the school?
A little bit, but not like in an advocate. I do staff trainings on how to best engage with families, and I work with families if they have questions on, like, how do I communicate this in a non-adversarial way to
Are these kids with problems or just parents that don't know what to do?
Anything. All of the above. Hmm. And working on behavior management, you know, and, like, home routines, how to get, you know, homework going and out the door in the morning.
Get a car.
No, and that's the thing. We all need it, right? I need it too. So I'm always happy to do the work, because then I go home feeling a little better about what I'm trying to do at home. So that's what I do.
Good.
I'm Caitlin Mercurio, and let's see, I have 3 kids under 5, or 5 and under. My husband and I have been here for 2 years.
You're a very busy lady.
Very busy, yeah. Let's see, I grew up mostly in Wilmington, although we did bounce around a little bit when I was a kid. I work in environmental engineering. I quit my job when we moved here, though I still do some like very part-time consulting for my former employer. But for the most part, I'm home. That's about it.
I should add, I'm working part-time for, before I went to law school, I was an admissions officer at Tufts, and now I'm working part-time again.
When were you there?
97 to 02.
Yeah, my son graduated there. My daughter was in what's the school for the alumni? The family owns the Giants as well. I can't remember the name. Who's the owner of the Giants?
Angela?
No.
Mara?
She did recruiting from the alumni, you know, fundraising from the alumni.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So I'm reading applications
again.
I did education law, special education law mostly. We also did some juvenile defense work, but mostly it was court-appointed work for students who were committed to the foster care system who needed IEPs or needed new school placements, also kids who were in juvenile court who needed that same service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Barry?
Yeah. Barry Berman, member of the Board of Selectmen since 2015? Yeah, 2 years, so 2015. Before that, I was on the Finance Committee, been a town meeting member. I ran for town meeting when somebody knocked on my door and said we need a new high school. And that was before we even had a kid. So I said, well, you know, these things take a while. So I kind of got involved. Professionally, I'm a banker. I do residential and commercial lending and private wealth management for clients in Boston. Before banking, I actually was in government. I was a legislative aide in the Massachusetts Senate for State Senator Jerry D'Amico, who served in the Worcester area. And from there, I went to the Kennedy School, got a degree in kind of community development, did some work for the city of Boston, and ran a nonprofit, and then decided 15 years after graduation, I needed to make more than $25,000 a year. Mm-hmm. So got into banking. But government and public service has been a passion of mine. So that's why I slog all these hours. Great rate of pay for the town of Reading. So.
The pay isn't great, but the benefits are.
Yeah, benefits are great. So,
Eric, Linda.
Well, I'm a Connecticut import. I have a half New York, half Boston accent. And when I met this guy in college, we lived in Rhode Island for a while, and he was from Wilmington. And he had been working at Polaroid, and they called him back because they were developing some new products, and that he had been in the military and was in school. And they called him back, and they said, on your vacations, on your summers, we need you back to get this new project, this new Cameron project going. I ended up working there later. I was a secretary. I worked as an administrative assistant, worked my way up into corporate communications. I ran large events, shareholders meetings, 50th anniversary. On the side, I developed an interest in antiques and got my auctioneer's license in 1982. We ran, before we had children, we ran 5 or 6 auctions a year. And then that slowed down and we had 2 daughters and who are in their 20s now, so we're out of the school system. And so when the kids came, the auction slowed down because it's a lot of intense work in a short period of time. And so I do that part-time, and he's self-employed. He started his own business in 85. So we did the antiques together, and he went into his business, and I went into antiques and auctioneering a little more separately.
And there you are.
And we moved to Reading. We lived in Wilmington for 20 years, and we moved here to Reading 20 years ago.
What's your last name?
Phillips,
okay.
There's a lot of Phillipses in Reading because we're related.
Oh, okay. Well, no, I have a lot of family from Wilmington, so.
In Wilmington, doing a lot of work with through Village Parenting, and then the schools and doing staff trainings and stuff. So.
But you've been there 20 years? That's how long I've been here.
No, we bought the house in 96 or 97.
Yeah, well, we actually purchased the estate.
We lived in Wilmington for a year while we totally renovated the house.
Because you were one of the people, when I first got on town meeting, you talked like you've been here for a million years. You were here as long as I am.
I got on town meeting 4 years after we moved here.
Okay, that's right.
Because I went to town hall and I started looking up the minutes, and Cheryl Johnson said, "You should be on town meeting. You spend a lot of time here reading the minutes." And I said, "Oh no,
you must
I
have
could
better
never
things
do
to
that.
Do.
I could never do that." And then, you know, auctioneering, you talk to strangers and all kinds of people.
And here you are.
Yeah.
So, I've got some prepared material, but it's only really to sponsor conversation. How do we want to work together?
Well, I think it would be nice to, I mean, as you know, we spent considerable time and energy on the document we produced, and in terms of our own work, but also in terms of engagement with the community and that
sure.
sort of thing. So
can you talk
I would
a little bit
like,
about like how that came about? I
yeah,
don't
sure.
Yeah, what's the backstory
yeah,
there?
Absolutely, yeah.
And I know a little bit about it, but you know,
sure.
We just saw the finished product. I'd love to hear about how you guys.
Yeah,
how
it was
that all came
kind
about.
Of randomly fate. We were mostly a group of strangers that.
How did you meet? How
happened
did these...
to all on the same day,
like randomly, all went for the first time.
Yeah, visited the Human Relations Advisory Committee meeting.
What day was that? Do you recall?
The first week in December.
Yeah, it was December.
And so one of the visitors to the meeting had come with an idea for a resolution here in town. I think the rest of us were sort of just there, I'll speak for me personally, just curious as to what types of human rights initiatives were going on in town. Mm-hmm. So wanted to visit the meeting. I kind of poked around a little bit on the website. I didn't really find a whole lot. It actually took me a while to find out which was the right group to go to. So in like human relations, I kind of skipped over that thinking it was like human resources or something like that. And then I finally like dug into it and I'm like, aha. So that's what brought me there. And then one of the folks had an idea for a resolution. She brought sort of some different ideas from things that she had seen going on around the country, had proposed it to the Human Relations Committee. And they sort of said that, you know, they're in the middle of planning Martin Luther King. They were kind of working on their structure, it sounded like, and it just didn't seem like they had the capacity to tackle anything like that
yeah.
at the time. So then the six of us just sort of pulled off into a side group and said, like, this
literally
is something.
Literally exchanged emails, like at that meeting
right
there.
Which six? When you say this?
Five. It was Demetra, Amy Cole, Kate
Goldlust.
Kate Goldlust and the two of us.
Okay.
So five, yeah.
And you said this was at an HRAC meeting in December. Mm-hmm. And who was the individual that had kind of the genesis of the idea?
Demetra.
I see. Was she the one introducing it at that meeting?
Yes.
I see.
Yep, yep. So we sort of just broke off and said, this is something we'd love to run with, exchanged, you know, emails, exchanged phone numbers, and we hung out in my living room and talked about it a couple days later.
Yep.
Right, and so you went through a lot of different iterations and...
Yeah, we met. Our pay is as good as yours. We met.
No, yours is worse.
But your refreshments.
We have to. You know, you don't have.
We can't drink during our meetings.
We did coffee mostly.
Yeah.
While the children were running and trying to be occupied, and so it was a great experience. I think that we didn't know in the town. If there was interest in this or not, we all knew that we were interested. And we have been doing some work with some other towns, just listening meetings and hearing what other people were doing. So we sort of heard a little bit about what other people were working on in other towns and thought, well, we could do this here. And personally, I was very interested to see the level of engagement when we proposed this. The clergy was certainly one of our first sort of ralliers or something, the clergy council here in town.
So you met with them? And,
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep.
Can I just clarify, when you say propose it, you're talking about kind of going out into the community to talk to people.
Right. Yes. Yep.
Not the, like, any...
Not a formal
proposal.
Right, exactly.
Okay.
Yep. So we talked to lots of folks in town, and it was a great experience for me to see the level of engagement from our fellow citizens. And I mean, you saw the numbers on that actually signed on was about 260, and that was with really no effort on our part, frankly.
Is that like kind of a social media?
Basically, like a post on Facebook.
I remember seeing something on there, but
which show website?
We did it
Facebook
through the Reading Community, Reading Parents Network, which now is like the Reading Community Network.
Yeah, so we use that. I think each of us sort of reached out to our own contacts. You know, I was emailing my friends and my neighbors saying, hey, look at this that we're working on. Do you have any feedback? Are you interested in signing on to this?
The clergy disseminated it
to people that they thought would be interested.
Yeah.
And did you guys have follow-up meetings? I know it was like 200-300 people that signed on to it. Did folks kind of say, oh, I'll sign on to it? But did other people kind of like, oh, this is, you know, what can I do kind of thing? Or was it like, was it a mushrooming kind of thing? Or was it, or what's your take? I guess my question is, what's your take on sort of, you know, since you kind of did this, you know, what are people saying about these issues?
So I think all of the above. You know, some people are just like, absolutely, sign my name. Other people had sort of their own feedback on the language. We had one gentleman add a comma. You know, you get all kinds of feedback.
Any of you guys on town meeting?
It was a different guy. I've already checked.
Oh.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I just a personal anecdote. I was walking down to my parents' house. I live next door, and I was reading it on my phone, which I know isn't very mindful of me, and I teach mindfulness, but, and I happened to know Gina from years ago. We knew each other, were in town, but I happened to know her, and I said, oh my gosh, and my eyes filled with tears, and I just felt proud. I was like, wow, our town's doing this. So that was my...
Yeah, and I think, just to add, very similar with other people, just sort of overwhelmingly positive responses that we've gotten from this.
And I also, it was important to me, you know, I've done some anti-bias training for myself and sort of bystander training, and it was important for me to have lots of voices look at the document, and I happen to have some attorneys of color that I went to school with, who are, one of them is active in Wakefield, right nearby. She's a Pakistani American Muslim woman. I asked her to read it on my behalf.
She's the one who spoke at the Martin.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, she's awesome. She's running.
Yeah.
And so she happens to be, you know, a legal colleague of mine from back then.
What's her name?
Maureen.
I don't remember.
And she spoke at the Wakefields,
okay.
Martin Luther King. Anyway, I had some folks look at it with a different set of eyes, just to get an understanding of whether they felt like it spoke to them. A colleague of mine who lives in D.C., who's an African-American woman who is also an attorney, who's very honest with me about lots of things, and spoke with the director of the Reading Metco program. I wanted it to speak to our students who were coming in to Reading from Boston. I felt like personally that was very important to me. We had Heather McLean look at it, who is active in the LGBT community. And so for me, it was important to have other voices look at it. And I will tell you that at least two of those women also welled up. That's what they told me when they read it and were proud of the document. So for me, I felt really, I don't know, it was a really good experience. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and I think her sharing that with the rest of us let us know that, like, we felt like we're going in the right direction, that we're definitely on something here.
Can I ask an ignorant question?
Yeah.
I'll tell you right now. What's the motivation behind it? What was the... And I say that earnestly. I don't understand. What was the purpose behind it? Was it to introduce a good? Was it to remedy what you thought was
no,
an evil?
I think we were very clear that we were hoping to be proactive because we had been working or listening to folks who were doing work in other towns. And there were some things going on in the surrounding communities that were very concerning, at least to me.
I'm making notes on the screen, so feel free to argue.
I'm not reading and talking.
That's all right. You can do it on later.
I personally know people who have lived here for 40 years who in December got yelled at in their hometown to go home and got called an awful name, which had never happened to them in 40 years. And it made me feel terrible. And another person I know who got a letter in their mailbox telling her that she should move out of the neighborhood because she was not white.
Let's take our autistic son with her.
Right. So it was a disability-motivated thing and a race-motivated thing.
Clarification. Yeah. Was it in Reading or surrounding?
No, it was a surrounding town. Yep.
It was Lexington.
It wasn't, but I don't. I'm not. I don't have.
There's
I'm
been
not
a
lot of
that.
Yeah.
Were these ever action? So this wasn't Reading. This was other cities.
Correct.
Yeah. All
this
of these.
All these.
Like Woburn or farther away. Or?
One was in Woburn. Another incident
in
Wakefield, Linfield.
Yeah.
Were these acted on by the police?
Some police departments were not interested. Some were.
You know for a fact they weren't interested, or they didn't have anything to go on, or they couldn't act on it. Or?
There was some controversy. I'm really not at liberty to go further. I apologize for being cagey. I don't mean to be cagey. I just don't have permission to go further.
But you characterize the issues all surrounding the ill will or wishing ill to folks that had been here for
a long time, and so for us, we were hoping to set a tone here in our town to have something to go back to and stand up around, rally around, if something were to happen, because I think some of the towns were not as, I guess, proactive in their response. And so for me personally, I felt like it was, if something happens here, we have your back kind of emotion that was motivating me. I don't know if that's the same.
Yeah, so I would say definitely the desire to be proactive instead of reactive, a desire to ask our town leadership to be one voice of many to say that this behavior is not okay, and that if it happens in Reading, you know, you're going to be met with resistance. Then I'll also add, the examples I think that Gina brought up are sort of more, you know, there's more public displays of this.
Mm-hmm. Right, these were just personal.
Or personal stories that we know of. Most of the stuff that's happening is behind closed doors, right? The only people that know about it are the perpetrator and the victim, right? It's a rolling down your window and yelling at, calling somebody a name as they're walking down the street. It's those little things that I can say, since starting this work and talking to people in Reading, people are giving me the thumbs up. Yes, we have stories like this.
Yeah, I know that I was not at the Human Relations Advisory meeting this past week, but one of the members did send me a copy of the survey, I guess, that had been done at Reading High School.
Very compelling, I thought.
That was just, and I think they broke it down by people who were, you know, who've been here, you know, who were originally from Reading or lived here, and then people who are just, who work, live, are educated in Reading, but do not.
Mm-hmm.
Live in Reading. And, you know, I say to my son who's 17, I said, you're so lucky you grow up in this era where just things seem to be more open and accept, you know, and just accepting than in my generation. But then you read some of the responses of just, you know, have you witnessed or were you a victim of? a number of things, and you know, it was.
Is that the behavior risk survey?
No. This was.
Unfortunately,
just,
this wasn't a recorded meeting. I don't know if somebody made an audio.
No, this is actually great. So a couple of high school girls took the initiative to build the survey.
Based on a request from Board of Selectmen for more information about why this is needed.
Oh, okay.
So from us?
No.
Maybe the school committee?
No, there's some real confusion on the HREC from our last meetings
from
in June.
Where that came from.
They are really confused.
Well, whatever. It sounds like they did a good.
Yeah, so it was high school students
it's a fine
that
body
put
of work.
Together the
yeah.
survey and distributed it throughout the high school.
Yeah. So not scientific, but enough responses to.
The strangest part of it.
300?
I think it was 400.
Yeah.
But enough to make you, you know. It wasn't a sample of a small number.
Right.
It was just, you know, just a casual kind of one or two stories. But
yeah.
And so you all know what I did. I was shocked what happened next when that was discussed. I was at the HREC meeting with, I had no idea, but three of my colleagues were there. We all kind of showed up independently. It happens sometimes, but I went there because it's a precursor to tonight. But I was shocked that what happened after that was introduced, which was you'd normally expect action to be taken. I mean, you've got people reporting acts of discrimination in the school to a group that is ostensibly interested in the subject matter. And as a practical matter, one of the school committee members is chairing that group. And it just went right to the next topic. So that you all know, that just boggled the imagination. If this is really happening at the school, what's the school doing about it?
Oh, actually, we had a conversation later, and that school committee member is addressed us, at least, and the students, just, and she may address it further. She didn't want to take away from what they were saying, but she had a very...
Yeah.
Lengthy response that I'm sure she'll.
But she's
she'll
a mandatory
share.
Reporter. She has to act on that. You can't hear that and just let it lie.
Yeah, but there were no specific acts. But
it's an anonymous.
Yeah.
Sorry, and
I think that's not really
as a mandated reporter. That's not something that. Yeah, that's a survey that was taken.
Not the survey. The verbal descriptions of those. Two or three young ladies, I can't remember how many were there.
Right.
Their personal.
Were a part of that survey. Administrators.
I'm not talking about
there.
The survey. They represented separate and distinct from the survey that they had heard and been involved with and seen. And the survey amplified that.
They were witnesses to what?
That's, again, I didn't get their names, and the room wasn't ideal. They were talking in soft tones. It was hard to hear at our end of the room.
Well, and we don't know what happened after.
Takeaway.
We don't know what happened after the meeting.
Yeah.
Well, but I do think that is a good point. So, with this document, and I think somebody, may have even been you, had the question in the last meeting, what's a document going to do, right? It's a piece of paper. What's a document going to do?
Yeah, that question, that answer on my part was misunderstood. What I was trying to say is, what's the purpose in doing this today versus getting it done next week? Can we do this in a more protracted way? And it came across differently. My intent was not, why do we need to do this? It was, why do we need to do this tonight?
Why
can't we get this done in a meeting like this?
Totally.
That's totally.
Well,
yeah.
To that end, you know,
you're gonna get a lot
I think
more
a
done.
Document is step one, right? We lead with our words and our actions. So step one, our words. What do we stand for in this community? Step two, the actions need to match up with the words. What do we have in place here in town?
Hmm.
And that's not something we're trying to tackle right now.
Right.
But
actually,
I'm hoping that this will start a conversation.
And for the record, you guys are here not representing Human Relations Advisory
Committee.
No, we're not
members of the committee.
We're just members
of
the community.
And I think that that's also, I mean, you guys are at the meeting and you know, sort of, we've been working with them and trying to figure out kind of the next step for them. I mean, so I think the problem or the resolution, you know, is you're right. It's a piece of paper, but you know, I guess my question is, and this is so totally not what I signed up for. Not that I want to avoid it, but when I decided to run for selectman, it wasn't about sort of these grand issues, right? I mean, you know, it wasn't about these kinds of things. It's like, we're going to fill the potholes. We're going to get the school teachers paid. We're going to plow the streets. We're going to make our, you know, we're going to try to make the town run efficiently. With the money that I didn't think of the role of a board of selectmen. to sort of think about the, not that I don't think about them as an individual and greatly affected by it, but I just sort of saw, like,
yep,
okay, well, this is, you know, that's kind of local government. I mean, Seth Moulton, you know, will deal with those issues, and Brian and Jason Lewis, and, you know, those are the kinds of, you know, sort of the grand things. But when people are reporting these kinds of things in our town, you know, it now kind of becomes a role of the selection, even though it's not something that maybe I would have thought about when I pull papers to run. And so that's an introduction to my next question is, what do you want to see of us, not just this piece of paper? What do you think our role in this is?
Well, I'll tell you that I, as I said, grew up in Melrose. And I, at Thanksgiving, the mayor of Melrose, they have a, their city, made a speech and posted it on his blog that was so wonderful to me personally, just in terms of talk. I think I have a copy of it, because I had grown up there, and it wasn't something that...
No, it was a different town when you probably growing up there.
Yeah, and so, and I was so interested to know what was going on there, talking about the country being divided and tensions have emboldened people to spread messages of division. Prejudice and hatred happen in isolation. The way to quell them is with community. We have much to be thankful for, and they were talking about all the things that, that they had done in their town is in the past. And she said, and so I ask you, as Thanksgiving draws near and we think of the many things we are thankful for, do we have the courage to stand up against all forms of hate? Do we have the courage to ensure that Melrose is a safe place for anyone, no matter who they are, where they come from, or who they love? Do we have the courage to respect every person and to listen with empathy to what they have to say? You know, I believe we do. We're thankful. One community open to all. This, and this was someone that, that went to my high school. And I just, I felt like it was someone that the students in my hometown could look up to. And I don't know, I was proud. And I thought, there are other towns doing this too. And why not mine? You know, this is my new adopted home. You know, I feel very close to Melrose, but this is now, you know, where my children are going to be raised. And so...
So, just recapping here, your group or individuals had been monitoring activities in other cities. You mentioned Woburn, Wakefield, and Linfield, where public issues of abuse or threats were known. There were issues around verbal or written abuse of certain individuals or classes of individuals. And again, I'm paraphrasing, but you're describing that the desired outcome of the proclamation is to put forth a proactive statement about unacceptable behaviors.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
I think that's great. Yeah.
We've got the audio track, but I'm just trying to summarize.
Yeah, I think that sums it up.
Good digestion.
How do you want to work together? You know, we've got a baseline now. We can continue going around the baseline and kind of getting the story out about how we got here. But how would you like to work forward?
I think we would like to hear very much your thoughts on the language that we wrote. So, I mean, I brought copies. I'm sure you have.
Well, before we go there, let me tell you a couple of things.
Mm-hmm.
Your thought is this would be a document vocalized and issued by the Board of Selectmen, true?
Yep.
Yes.
Ideally, it would be a document that's written by the Board of Selectmen. I mean, it might incorporate thoughts and concepts and ideas, but it's actually authored by the Board. Now, that's not to say we can't take somebody else's work and reuse
it. Is there a precedent for that? I don't see any.
See, I actually think that the strength of this is that it came from the community. So I think that it's written by the community, for the community, and I picture this as us asking
right.
for your endorsement. Not that we can't go through language and you know hear thoughts.
So you're looking for
support of this effort,
but not necessarily a repetition or a recitation of it. I'm picking at it because words are powerful things,
mm-hmm.
and there are some observations from the document you've. This is the webpage you talked about. This Reading Parents Network, is that the one you were talking about earlier?
I think I posted it there.
Yeah.
Reading Community Network, I wrote down.
They added a new subtitle to it.
Yeah. Okay. Is this it here? Reading Community Network up
yep.
there?
Yeah.
So,
okay.
I mean, that is one
I posted it there. We posted it
okay.
To some PTO pages.
Yeah. I remember seeing it, but I can't remember where.
Yep.
So I went through the existing document, and I've asked a couple of folks who would know, and a couple of observations.
Mm-hmm.
The current document isn't a product of the Board of Selectmen. That doesn't have to be, but ordinarily, if you want folks to stand up and say, these are my words, ideally they should be at least contributing to it. There are statements of fact in the whereas paragraphs
mm-hmm.
that aren't accurate. As a point of fact, not all residents are committed to upholding.
Actually, yeah,
we were just talking about that this morning, so I don't know if... Bill.
We actually have someone we work with has spoken to him specifically, and we have ideas. Bill Brown
had a comment in the Chronicle about, you know, taking issue with the fact that we were trying to speak for all residents
mm-hmm.
in
yeah.
the town. We talked about it afterwards, and I think that makes complete sense, and I think that is something that we're totally amenable to
right.
to working around.
But that's one of the things working together will work out.
Yeah.
Our board has no authority to direct other elected officials. We can say we do. We can say powerful words, but we actually have no direction at all. They're independently elected boards.
Sure. So I actually spoke with Chief Sagala.
Yeah.
And because I would
sure.
love to get the department to sign
right.
on, and he would be happy to have that conversation with me after. You know,
right.
he didn't want to jump ahead and endorse
sure.
it
sure.
before
Although there
getting
is,
the Board of Selectmen's blessing.
The deputy chief does serve as an ex officio member of on HVAC. So, I mean, they're engaged on these issues.
They're there as a staff member on HVAC, along with Matt. The board has no authority over public safety officials. We can appoint fire and police chiefs and assistant chiefs, but we don't direct their conduct at all. So any words that speak to what police and fire should do in terms of enforcement, there's nothing.
I would say we should, in the process of this, I mean, if they're interested in signing on to it, then, I mean, if they endorse it.
Again, I'm responding
yeah,
directly
yeah.
to the comment of the document as written.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. And other communities have issued the statement jointly.
Right.
The Board of Selectmen
yep.
and the Police Department
right.
have jointly issued the statements.
There's a concept in writing called pride of authorship. And what that means is oftentimes an individual or sometimes a group develops a sense that this body of work is theirs and it's perfect. I'm going to say this very crudely. It's perfect or ideal the way it is. And therefore, any constructive attempt to make improvements is viewed negatively.
No, I think every single thing that you brought up,
yeah.
we've said, yeah, we should
Correct.
We should work on that.
I'm exactly in the opposite camp, but oftentimes that can happen. And lastly, just this is my own two cents, I think one of the things this note should maybe convey is we ought to celebrate free speech. One of the reasons that disagreement comes about is that there isn't enough conversation. And it's fine to hold contrary views, and it's really the practice of free speech that needs to be enforced and celebrated. It's really hard to, I don't know any way to prohibit unacceptable behaviors because people can act unacceptably.
But prohibiting is a completely different First Amendment bailiwick than what this is. And it's, I know the devil is in the details, but.
Right, so you understand what I'm poking at.
I'm
yeah.
an attorney.
Exactly.
I would never agree to something that was looking to prohibit speech.
Right. So even things like prohibiting or speaking against words of hate.
What are words of hate? Who defines what the words of hate are?
Barry, if you want to jump in.
I think you know it if you heard it.
I disagree
with
it's
that.
It's not, people don't even agree on what that is because what is hateful to one thing is venting to another.
I think what this document, I think this is a document that sort of sets the rules of engagement in town, you know, in civic matters.
It's not going to affect anyone's behavior.
No, and in fact, actually, I had a problem with one of the clauses that talked about sort of, nothing in here where I would agree to anything in here that talks about, well, you can't say this or you can't say that. But if you are going to engage in that behavior, there's a community standard that you can say what you can say what you want, but there's a community standard. I view this document kind of as aspirational in that, this is how we're going to engage in civic matters in the town of Reading. I can't legislate what's in your mind or in your heart, right?
But how we think about things is how we behave about things, and how we talk about things reflects how we feel about things. It all feels different when it happens to you, number one. So that can be an exaggerated response to someone saying, that was hateful, what you said to me. Like when the kids are little, they'd say, you hurt my feelings. Which feeling did I hurt, dear?
That's a favorite line of one of our daughters. You hurt my feelings. Yeah. You pronounce it correctly.
But,
well, they're going to get hurt a lot more if you don't do a jab.
Pardon my breath.
Because what someone doesn't think is hate speech, someone else can. So it's all in the matter of the interpretation of the person, depending on your background, sometimes your ethnicity, sometimes the color of your skin, sometimes your personal life experience.
Sure, and I don't think... we're not trying to incorporate this into policy. We're not the word police. I think that it's a resolution, and it, we're trying to set the tone. So a resolution is a statement of opinion. And I don't know that we need to specify exactly what constitutes hate.
Well, but if you're putting it in writing about hate, then it needs to be defined.
So, can you remind me of your first name?
Linda,
sorry, I knew it began with an F. So, I think one of the things that's initially, I don't know if the word is confusing, because I had some of the same thoughts of is this binding when I first read it. It's not, and I think that is very clear from the efforts made by the Citizens Initiative that this is not attempting to be binding. Like, no one's going to say, you can't do that, there's a resolution against it. It's not that, but I have a friend who is scared right now. She lives in Reading, and she's scared. She's scared. She's scared for her children. She is of Muslim faith. She's scared. She doesn't know what to tell her kids. We've been having conversations, not just since the election, but for a year now. She said, one day I overheard in the library, I'm so glad we finally moved to Reading where there's not diversity. And I said, oh my gosh. And she said, I got really nervous being here. Now, this resolution doesn't do anything to those people.
Right.
But what it does for my friend would be to say, I've got people that value that I'm here. And it would make me, when I was looking for a town to live in, I chose Reading for a number of reasons, and I'm super glad I came here. This would have been an additional reason for me to come and say, yes, I want to be in a town that's accepting. Not that it means without this that we're not accepting, but it's just, it's aspirational.
A number of people have actually gotten together and thought about it and decided to kind of put a stake in the ground and say, this is how we're going to do things in this town.
But it's unlikely to stop the behavior in the library.
Right.
But, correct. But it's likely to make my friend feel good, feel better.
I'd be more than happy to have your friend over for tea and explain to her why there's no need to be fear, the bigger issue of the fear-mongering that goes on a lot. Right?
Well, it's nice to know the Phillips family would be welcoming.
We do. We have people over all the time.
But it's that,
We've got a homeless person living in our house right now.
I think that also goes back to, these are the words, and we hope that there's follow-up conversation from this about the actions in our town. What kind of education programs do we have around this? What would our response be if there is a very public display of, you know, nobody's going to argue that it was a hate incident? What happens here?
So that came up the other night at the HRAC, where they were reviewing minutes, and the discussion turned to the subject of hate crimes. And David Clark, our deputy chief, raised his hand and says, we didn't discuss hate crimes. Hate crimes is a specific legal term.
Sure. We talked about the difference.
Yes.
He helped us understand the criminal code.
Right, but it wasn't clear in the minutes, so he was clearing that up. So that's his biggest fear, is that these words have a specific legal meaning and there's a legal threshold, and he's fearful that it gets either misused or trivialized. Yeah. Here's the thought. What if we wanted to talk about behaviors. What if we talked about expected rather than undesirable? What if we turned this to the realm of the positive rather than the negative?
So first thoughts on that. I think it's important to call out the behavior. In a time where it's seemingly become acceptable.
What does call out mean to
do this?
What do you think that means?
To condemn it. I think that there's a difference between saying that this is not okay versus saying, let's all be kind to one another. I think that it's two very different things. And I think because of what's going on right now, we need voices to say that it's not okay.
And our president, I was interested to see what he said on it too, because he's actually used the word condemn in his speech. You know,
well, we'll let him defend that.
But it's the same sentiment. So I feel like, you know, there's been this discussion.
So when you
from a lot of angles,
when you I'm assuming that when you researched this, you went and you kind of looked at what a lot of other towns
mm-hmm.
were doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you probably have made copies of kind of, you know. So one question is, first of all, are we new to the game on this, or is this, you know,
nationwide, there's a lot. In Massachusetts, I have a couple here that I've printed.
Yeah,
Canton,
as well.
Medford,
and they're condemning.
Springfield,
and
Belmont.
And that was my next question, is sort of, you know, the town, you know, the town manager's summary of what he thought the town council would say about, you know, the board of selectmen sort of saying, you know.
Of the policy.
Not on the policy, but on the resolution.
No, he didn't talk about the resolution.
About
he never read the resolution. That was the whole problem.
About the free speech. In any of the other resolutions, how do they deal with the notion, you know, here it is, and you're going to have a board of selectmen, an executive body of the government dealing with First Amendment. You want to be able to kind of condemn the behavior. You want to say, this is a town we believe strongly in these values, without saying, you know, without basically prohibiting someone from utilizing their First Amendment rights. So I'm sure that those towns have gone through this thought process also. And how?
Sure.
You know,
and in fact,
is there language that would, you know, that we could weave
yeah.
into this that would satisfy?
Yeah.
So two things. One is that the document that we created it. You know, we didn't just pick a document from another town and slap it on paper. But we created it looking to the other language that was used.
You know, if you did that, actually, no one would accuse you of plagiarism. That's about 95% of all the...
A lot of this
don't
stuff
recreate the wheel.
A lot of this is
yeah,
circular
don't
logic.
Recreate the wheel. So we did that. And we've also dug in, and frankly, I don't really know that I want to get into this conversation without town council, but we've done our legwork on local government's ability on free speech. You know, we've went to the Supreme Court cases and pulled out
Actually, I'd be
what we think
in
is
kind
the backup.
That, you know, because, I mean, I'm not a lawyer, and, you know, in general, we're generally wise when we defer to our town council, because otherwise we wind up getting sued for lots of money, and that doesn't make people very
happy.
Well,
and I think that in the end, you will anyways. And if he's more conservative in his opinion, that's what you have to follow.
And then it's up to us to decide how far we want to take that advice.
And so I just want you all to know that we didn't take this lightly, and we didn't come out of left field, and there was nothing about what we were doing that was attempting to prohibit speech by the citizens of this town. And specifically, that's not what we were doing. By introducing a resolution, is a statement of opinion, and it does not carry the force of law, first of all, in the first basket. But the second basket is learning about prohibiting versus stating an opinion. And so I want to make it very clear that nothing that we did was intended to prohibit speech.
I think the issue with town council, which we've now heard, is that the term hate speech as a legal term is ill-defined. There are so-called fighting words that are meant to incite or lead to incitement.
It's like calling someone a racist.
But that's the Supreme Court cases surround prohibitions. When you make a law that says you may not do X, or else you are going to get fined. You know, the biggest cases lately are of the political signs. You know, what is its time, manner, and place, you know, regulations, is it content-based or whatnot? And
it can't be content-based.
Correct. Now, that's for a law. So if you were going to say, and I want to put it on record, I am not barred in Massachusetts. None of this is my legal opinion.
Sure.
This is my personal research and my lay person's understanding from our research and our talking. Because we've talked to various folks at the state level also about sort of the level of legal scrutiny that a resolution would get versus a bill that someone was introducing. Quite different. And I think there are ways maybe that we can tailor the language that's there. I mean, I'm interested to hear what town council says, because it is a very interesting area of the law. I mean, I think we could probably all talk about it forever. And if he is very conservative about it, then that's what we have to defer to. I mean, that's what we're going to do.
The way this is, the town council will not be at these meetings. We're going to presumably get a document that comes out of the subgroup. We'll present it back to the rest of the board, town council to review it. So our task is to actually develop, either from the raw material that exists or from that and other inputs, a suitable resolution. And then that'll go to town meeting.
Barry, is that your understanding?
I think ultimately if we want five people, I mean, if you want the vote to be 5-0.
Yeah.
And I think you do and I do, frankly.
3-2. I don't want it to pass 3-2.
Yeah.
Or to go down 2-3.
Yeah.
I think that there's enough tweaking that could get done. I actually liked the concept of the way yours was done. I think we brought up a number of issues that were brought up here,
mm-hmm.
that can certainly get tweaked. My view is not that we have to basically take all the work that you did and just, you know, throw it in the fireplace and just write up something totally different. I think that you've got a really strong base here, but that to address some of these concerns and make this language stronger, I think is probably a good way to proceed. But starting off from, you know, kind of the passion and the direction of what you have proposed, and just address some of those kinds of questions that have come up, I think we'll make a better document.
Okay, so I think that doing that without word on town council is going to be difficult.
Well, the first barrier is, there's two barriers. What is legal and what will pass the five board members?
Yeah.
I think they're almost different reviews. Barry and I can speak at least probably to an 80% level what the other three guys are likely to do. No guarantees, but I've known most of them over the last several years. And I'm not an attorney by any stretch, don't ask me anything. But I think if we stay out of the realm of defining what speech is, I think that'll go a long way. And ascribing to the Board of Selectmen rights or responsibilities they don't have, either by, it's one thing to say it's just a proclamation, but to be honest with you, if I'm staying there and it's my name on the proclamation, I really want it to be something that I'm responsible for.
And I would love, I think it would be really useful for us to sort of go through the document and see, you know, which sections feel the most problematic,
yep.
So that we understand, you know, for efficiency's sake, how much we're working on. Does that make sense?
I guess.
I just wanted to clarify. Are you looking for endorsed by Board of Selectmen or authored by Board of Selectmen? Because those are two
exactly.
things.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, I imagine this to be endorsed by different groups in the community.
I mean, that was my understanding.
Right.
That
the school committee,
the board of selectmen,
when you said proclamation, that's a code word for us, and maybe that's another aha moment. We do proclamations all the time, mostly for events of civic or social note.
Right.
Girl Scout Gold Award, Boy Scout Eagle Award,
mm-hmm.
National Dispatchers Week, any particular a teaching week. And it's a little formulaic, but it's mostly to call attention to the public, the notoriety of that event. It's not original news. We're not making news of our own. We're kind of putting the imprimatur of the town government, or whatever that's worth, around the proclamation, documents given to a representative of the group. It might be an individual that takes it. It might be some certifications that come from the state leaders as well. That's what I thought you were going at.
We never called it a proclamation, so we're sort of naive
called a resolution.
But somehow the word proclamation got wrapped into this.
I saw it here first on
the
slide.
I think that someone
actually
may
also
have
John Halsey
it.
Had used it as,
yeah.
I think in that.
This English is a really tough language to
speak. Yeah, so I mean, we intentionally chose the word resolution.
And the proclamations are written, the style of how they wrote it had a proclamation feel, but it was written as a resolution.
So you're not, just to clarify, you're not looking that a document that either starts with this or looks like this or has the same concepts of this is authored by the Board of Selectmen and issued as a document of their own. That's not what you're looking for, or is it?
I think we could have a discussion about it. I mean,
I'm not advocating. I'm just trying to find out what
you're doing. I think our original intention was to ask for your endorsement.
Right.
That's what I thought it was.
To move on
and
ask for the school committee's endorsement, to ask for,
the police chief
Scala's endorsement. And our hope is for the community in the town of Reading to embrace it in some form to help us get the message out there. I don't know that it was our intention to have this and then down at the bottom.
Well, I have to tell you, that was confusion point one in my mind. When the group came in, and obviously you were well prepared, and there was 30, 40 people in the room, I was under the strong understanding that you wanted this as a proclamation, and you wanted it on our documentation, and you wanted it with our seal and issued with our signature. That's what I thought you were coming in for. Now, if that wasn't your intent,
if you loved it and you wanted to own it, that would be great.
Well, I thought that's what I thought this meeting was to try to figure out how to hammer out such a document.
So
it doesn't have to be.
I'm confused back to step one here when I saw this on TV last week. What's the purpose? What is it going to do? Why is it taking all this time and all these people? And it's like, if you want someone to join your group, then throw it up to the editor and ask for people to start another little subcommittee and talk among yourselves and spread the good word, like spread the gospel of tolerance or whatever.
Sure,
it is.
And that's a piece of it.
But it's like,
but
so
we are wanting
people,
the town to take a voice in it too.
Because that's where you get into trouble with people interpret and misinterpret what you're trying to do. When I saw what happened at that meeting, I said, they're not doing what they're even saying here, the behavior. That was
the feeling I got to, and I
was
very,
it
as well.
Was
yeah,
very
no,
shocking
yeah.
if you're trying to talk, express goodwill through the community, and you go into a board, the top board that's responsible for the whole town, and say, we want you to do this. That was like, if my kids came in and said, I want you to do this, I'm like, no, I don't think I'm going to unless you can.
I think both
you know,
groups kind of talked at each other a little bit in that meeting.
It was clearly that, but I think it was almost guaranteed to fail given the way it started. Just
my
you can't,
understanding that meeting that maybe you watched was like step three into it. And so there were, I think, and I entered at that point. I think there were strong emotions coming in. So
well, I didn't understand why the emotions were so strong. If you have a winning point, you go and you put your arm around someone and say, I really like you, and you know, you annoy me in some areas, but we can still be good neighbors.
But I think
and
that's
we'll
why we're here. That's why we're
other,
here. You know, I think this
like
is
that.
All.
But I don't need to say to my neighbor, you have to sign this because we have to
actually,
share the driveway.
That's where the meeting went off the rails for me.
Is
it was my. Maybe false impression, but it was my impression that was the demand, was that it be signed as is. And obviously I'm hearing
or
now that...
Or endorsed.
Well, again, I had proclamation on the brain maybe. I'm not sure where that came
yeah.
from.
Well,
but,
sure, so...
That's when I went off the
I
rails.
I mean...
Because you can't do that in a meeting of 30 people.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess it sounds like two different things here. Well, it can't do that in a meeting of 30 people, but we had presented it the meeting prior, and so... We, through emails, had been under the assumption that it had been reviewed. It had been reviewed
yeah.
by town council.
A lot of
so there was a lot of misunderstanding going on behind the scenes.
A lot of times what happens when meetings
yep.
kind of get a little testy at the Board of Selectmen level, it's because people have different expectations of what they think is going to happen on that. Not that they're
yeah.
ascribing
yeah.
goodwill or bad will to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
It's just people came in, I thought we were going to do this, and... Yeah, you know, so that's
it's expectation
and no
setting.
No one likes to be cornered either. It's like I didn't know, you know, when your kids come last minute, I didn't know you needed it now. Why didn't you?
I will
me
tell
this
you as well. Nothing on that board gets deliberated in two meetings. It's just I'm so frustrated with the speed of government because I work in the commercial industry and I'm doing stuff. And I get calls in the morning. We're solving problems in the afternoon. It kills me how slow it goes.
Sure, and to that point, one of the reasons. For me personally, that I would like to work with this language is because I don't want this to get drawn out.
I don't think it has
over
to.
Over months.
I don't think.
I
would like to turn this around and,
sure.
and get it voted on because it's pertinent to right now.
This is something that, there's a number of things I could say, a number of thoughts I've had as I listen. Do you feel like it really is in the purview of your responsibility to go ahead and let one group go ahead and present a resolution like this that in turn is going to represent the whole town?
No.
In other words,
no.
The town at large, I take issue with a few things I see.
They're private citizens. They can do whatever they want.
Well,
and they have.
Right.
This has been published in the paper.
Oh, right, but it reflects on them. If you were to go ahead and endorse this resolution, then you're out there really representing the entire town. For instance, let me just give you some contrary cuts on this. When you talk about condemn all words and acts of hate and indifference, that's all subjective. Well,
that's the question I raised
right.
that night.
That's,
no,
that's the
there's
main
no such thing as an act
now.
Of indifference.
But
you can't have an act of indifference.
And if
we
take, I guess it would be interesting to me if we took out that section. I'm interested to hear the other sections. Because I think that we all have to discuss
that's
that
probably the
part.
Big trick.
That was,
well,
that,
well,
that was the
please,
clause that I think got.
Sure, but
clause.
Take the word indifference with the words around it. Indifference that undermines our neighborhood's community. You got to take it all together.
I get it. But
not any old indifference.
But there's no requirement of a citizen to do anything. If you
right.
care about it, you do something. But there's no legal
right.
requirement.
And there's no requirement here either. You cannot like something, and governments actually have the right to have an opinion. So if you have an opinion and want to express it, that's fine.
I'd rather state that in the form of a positive.
See,
I'd rather
see,
state
here's
it.
Here's the problem.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt
sure,
you.
Sure, Gary, go ahead.
But here's like, I'm searching, combing my mind here for an example that would represent what could be a potential problem area. Okay, one of my pet studies over the years has been the scientific evidence for creation. Okay, now I can state this dogmatically because I believe it's so. Evolution is not scientific fact. Okay, neither is creation. But to go ahead and present evolution as fact to our students in school, to me, is contrary to everything you are representing about your view of people. To say we came from animals is demeaning and diminishes the value, the worth, the meaning, significance of life, okay? Now, here's the thing.
I think you're using that as an example of speech that you would find problematic.
Well,
yeah?
John, an entire chapter of my child's textbook presented evolution as fact, and it's not.
Okay, I think we're going down a little bit of a rabbit hole here.
No, I'm not trying to get into the evolution-creation
right.
debate. What I'm saying is, it's policy to say you came from an animal. Okay, to me, that is the epitome of hate speech. It's actually governmental policy to present evolution as fact. Okay, so what I'm saying is, it is subjective. It is subjective. I value, as a Christian, every human life very, very highly. But at the same time, I conclude this in my years of experience as a believer and half educated in this area of basic doctrine and so on, that not all things are good for people. And some of the things that are being pushed as social agenda are, in my opinion, as a Christian, not good for all people.
Gary, is there anything in this document as a Christian? No.
This is the point. But what I'm saying is, when you go ahead and you have language like that particular item,
I think what you're trying to say is people may have contrary views, and they're perfectly legitimate contrary views.
In other words, to distill it down, okay? We all have the potential to be selective about what we think is good and bad. Good for people, bad for people. What's harmful and what is not, okay? And I don't want to lose my summary remark here. The thing is that I think things like this are best left, if you really want diversity, to a committee to say, look, this is our policy as a human...
Relations committee.
But that's not that. We're people.
Sorry?
We're just citizens.
And plus, the HREC can't have a policy that's counter to... I think your point is anything that inhibits free speech and action of free speech is counter to the rights of free speech. You're giving an example, but when you distill it down, that's really what it is. You want to believe what you believe, and that's a form of free thought of expression.
But you see, some of us have a fear that this is really a mask to advance what you see as your values on different issues, okay? But you see how powerful the point is that I'm making? That our society presents something to the kids as fact when it is not. To me, that is hate speech. Okay, that's very destructive. Let me just sum it up this way, okay? And either this is going to take and have
I do think it's I think it's out of scope though, Gary. I understand you're trying to make a point, but I think the topic is out of scope.
You know, I think that not every person in our community is going to agree with this. And to that point, I think that Bill's point of
Bill Brown's
yeah. point where we say Reading residents, right? As if we're speaking for Reading residents.
Right.
We're intending to rework
all of that. Yeah.
We know this will not speak for every person, but we want to ask our leadership to take an opinion. And not everybody in the community is going to have that same opinion, but it doesn't mean that we can't ask our leaders to voice that opinion.
But because everybody doesn't agree with that, for leaders to take that position.
But they do it all the time.
Let me just read you something.
The five of us voted to put an override on the ballot, right?
Mm-hmm.
That we believed in, obviously, or we wouldn't have voted for it.
Mm-hmm.
60% of the people in town disagreed, mm-hmm. right? So leaders take positions all the time.
But that's different. We put a question on it.
You don't have to.
Well, I think the case that they're making is that we're at a crossroads in time where we have to.
So do other people have to go out and get 500 signatures for you to go to the selectmen and say, they got 300, we got 500,
but
we don't want you to sign the petition? Is that what this is going to come to? Every little group who has a specialized agenda is going to go before the Board of Selectmen and say, we want your imprimatur to approve of what we've done because we put a lot of time into it.
Yeah, but these
and we want you
these
to add
to
power to our words
these,
by endorsing
these. What they have brought to us
mm-hmm.
is we're kind of sweeping, they're asking us to kind of set the tone as political leaders. And again, not something that I thought was in the job of a Board of Selectmen.
Right.
To address
that's what
sort
I
of these sort of grander thing.
Why are you coming
you know,
to us?
And the
this?
Fact that, and actually one of the things that we haven't really talked about was that, and I think when you guys first had presented the resolution, Bob on his own went back and just said, you know, what are our policies on this, right? I mean, and these policies haven't been looked at maybe for 30 years.
Well,
it and
was,
attempted
yeah.
to kind of say, okay, well, the resolution is fine, but what, you know, what are the actionable items? The actionable items is to say, okay, this is maybe the preamble, and the nitty gritty of what we do are within our policies. And he attempted to actually go a step beyond what you guys had actually asked for, which was to kind of just work it into our policy, which I thought was kind of, well, that's a really great thing. We have a resolution that kind of sets the tone, and the policies really kind of put, you know, suspenders on it and kind of, you know, put flesh to the bone about, you know, how we're going to operate in town. And I thought together, as you know, each kind of supporting the other was a really good thing. And the answer to your other question, you know, the fact that 50 people came in the room and really were passionate about it, signed by a large number of people, probably more than if you actually had the time and did it, I think really speaks to kind of how people are feeling. And so my point is that if 500 people came in and said, we do something else, we would look at it. We might not agree. But, yeah, we would look, yeah, we would look at
it. And, you know, they have to vote for it if they agree with it. We're not asking them to say, agree with this, sign it now, or else. I mean, we're presenting something, and if you agree with it, and if you would like to express that as your opinion, vote for it. Not everybody in the community is going to have the same opinion, but elected leaders can take an opinion. So we are asking if you share our opinion, endorse it.
You know, this is a point in time document, right? 2017, point in time document where five sitting Board of Selectmen said, you know, this is the right thing to do. And then we have policies that are probably sort of more ingrained. And the fact that one working off the other, I think, is a really positive thing. And so, you know, we take votes all the time on things that we know there are some people aren't going to be. We have to kind of blanch this to the point where 100% of the people are going to have to agree with 100% of the things that are in there. But if you agree with sort of the broader concepts about how we're going to operate in this town, you know, there's some people who are going to be against it. There's, you know, going to be some people against everything.
I think Linda's point, though, taken at the core, is in a perfect world, you'd want to make a statement that all the members of the board could support and the overwhelming majority of the members of the town could.
Mm-hmm.
And my mind keeps going to what is civil, what is lawful, what is proper discourse, what is guaranteed by the Constitution and the laws of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And we can also talk about the values of diversity. Where I part ways, I think, is when it comes to talking about prohibitions of behaviors or words or actions that are actually guaranteed.
Sure, and
they
we're
may,
not trying to move
they,
out of
they may be
that.
Distasteful, they may be
absolutely.
Ugly, they may be, but speech was, free speech was instituted primarily for unpopular speech. The popular speech
mm-hmm.
doesn't really need a lot of safeguarding.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's where I have a problem. And
mm-hmm.
a secondary issue was, and it's just a stylistic thing, the whole wherefore, therefore, who art, never did it for me. It's a
And
it's
I,
a waste
I
of a bunch of space.
I mean, that's the style that we saw.
I know. It's right
so
out of 17th
we're just
century
neophytes,
England,
you know?
Right? But I think getting it more pithy and more. Like Barry had a candidate that he distributed to the board. It was a single paragraph, and I thought it was on point. I don't think you may not want to bring it up, but I thought that style, which was a single paragraph, maybe three sentences, was enough.
Yeah, I think I was kind of just sort of writing down was kind of.
But that's form. That's not substance.
Yeah. Yeah.
More just about kind of just that one clause that I get.
But Linda's point, I think, is how do we get more than half the town to say, you know, that's a no-brainer. Do we want to pick on our neighbors because they don't look like us? Of course not. Do we want to take issue with what's said in the library? If it's said, well, you might use it as a teachable moment. Kids say stupid things. Right? Kids do stupid things. But when you go beyond that and you try to say, we're as a town are not going to, we're going to try to set policy. That's...
Who's saying that? That we're trying to set policy?
We said it earlier in this discussion.
I feel like these themes keep. I'm like I said, I'm at the sort of the forefront of understanding, but I feel like there's a gap of understanding that I keep hearing you and other board members say we can't set policy and we can't prohibit, and we're not like they're not is what I'm hearing, and I keep hearing like proclamation or prohibit.
Condemning.
Or
should we take a position around condemning what is lawful behavior?
And I think that's a judgment that you need to make.
Yeah.
And if that's the sticking point, then
and that's
let's
Linda's
talk
point.
About it.
That's
yeah.
Linda's point, I think, and that is
yeah.
some significant subgroups. My daughter went to school in Northwestern University in Chicago, next door to Evanston, where that was, is Skokie, Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
Some of you remember Skokie, the American Nazi
mm-hmm.
Party marched through.
Mm-hmm.
Huge.
Supported by the ADL.
Pardon me?
Supported by the ACLU.
The Anti-Defamation League went crazy. The citizens went crazy. It was protected speech.
Mm-hmm.
So you can say what you want about the Nazi Party, but they, and Lord knows, there's not much to redeem them.
The more
them.
You make a fuss about it, the more they're going to do.
Unfortunately, what they wanted was attention-getting
yeah.
behavior, and they got it, right?
Right.
Do you remember when the Westboro Baptist Church
yep.
came to Reading?
Oh,
they were protesting.
Funeral
or something? No, the high school was doing a play.
I'm gonna grab one of these.
About I think it
was it the Laramie Project?
The Laramie Project. That was it. Which was I guess where the gay high school student was murdered.
Right.
So they reenacted that, and Westboro Baptist Church came from Kansas, set up right on site. You know, they were there. They were behind barricade. This was maybe 8-9 years ago.
Yeah, there's no shortage of these sorts of things.
In Reading, and there was probably 10 times that number of Reading people on the other side with signs saying, you know, we're supporting our high school students on this play.
And lots of people in this country, straight up to the top, say things like, you know, like President Trump did, saying, I can't find the paper, but... These things we don't like. Where's the paper? Because I thought that how he phrased it was actually very nice. Yeah, this one. Recent threats targeting Jewish community centers and vandalism of Jewish cemeteries, as well as last week's shooting in Kansas City, remind us that while we may be a nation divided on policies, we are a country that stands united in condemning hate and evil in all of its forms. That was his speech, you know, to the...
Those are hate crimes, and you go shooting up.
Those are hate crimes, but...
And that's the problem. If you apply those labels to lesser protected speech items, it's a disproportionality. He's talking about actual acts. He's condemning acts, not words.
Mm-hmm. And he also, on 60 Minutes, I don't know, you probably remember when he was interviewed, there was a talk about this issue, and Trump directed his comments to his own supporters, whom Stahl had said have written racist slogans or chanted degrading messages, particularly in schools. And he said, I'm so saddened to hear that. I say stop it. If it helps, I will say this. I will say right to the cameras, stop it.
Yeah, we can say, look, this is the speech is protected, the message is awful.
Yeah.
I think that's the point.
Yeah.
You got to find
and
a way to...
I think we can work... I think that there's sort of more elegant language that we could put
mm-hmm.
in there.
And actually, there was an interesting one that I found. You can let me know what you think about this. Whitefish City Council declares, this is from Montana, Whitefish City, declares its support of Whitefish community values that recognize and celebrate the dignity, diversity, and inclusion of all its inhabitants, condemn ideologies, philosophies, and movements that deny equality of human rights and opportunities, and challenge our constitutional freedoms granted by the United States. Nothing in this resolution is intended to alter or abridge other rights, protections, or privileges secured by state or federal law.
They address it directly in the document.
Including state
okay.
and federal constitutional protections of freedom of speech, assembly, and exercise of religion.
I
so
like
they're restating the guarantees.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like black letter law, right?
Yeah.
That's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
It's when you, I think you get into, I'm not an attorney, and when I try to describe legal stuff, it comes out all jumble-mumble because I don't know the right words, and it's... In my space, I can do things very good, but outside my space, I can't. I'd be comfortable actually trying to get to something. I believe the other board members would also be
mm-hmm.
equally comfortable getting to what I'd say.
If we added,
so if we added language like that,
additional
in,
language, maybe.
I'd actually try to fold. I like that format. See how condensed that is.
This was from a.
But I wouldn't actually try to copy it. I'd try to get ideas on a page, just the ideas. Forget about the format and forget about the words that join the ideas together. Let's just get the ideas in some format and a framework. Somebody else can gin up the language. The concepts here, I think, are guarantees already established by under the law for
in
speech.
In other words, you're not taking anything away in order to promote a different idea.
These are guarantees of speech, free association, thought, exercise of religion, defense of same, and then you might actually say, and that will the board would potentially take issue with any particular message that's contrary to the guarantees provided by these. And then we can call out particular actions individually, like a Laramie Project or whatever happens next. That's what I meant by pride of authorship.
Like
I'm not saying this is not great. What I'm saying is I don't think you're going to get 5-0 on this in its current form.
And I just have a question about it was very interesting what you said, that we fear or people... There's a bunch of people that would fear that this is a mask for a different agenda or an agenda we would agree with. And would that kind of language feel good to you guys? I'm just curious.
Would that what? Say it again.
If it tied back to federal law or state law or established black letter law, guarantees, civil liberties that are already guaranteed. Do you have that? Can you have that copy?
Yeah.
Can you pass that over?
Well, that's why I think my point about, I know most people... view creation science, and there is such a thing. You can go to icr.org if you're interested at all, okay? But
what they're saying, Gary, to state this in terms of constitutional freedoms guaranteed by the United States, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, that prevent the exercise and free expression of people to exercise civil rights, speech, freedom of assembly, and freedom of discrimination. And here's an example. It's from Montana, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably the wrong, but it's that style.
Put them side by side.
Yeah, it is.
Because then I think you're tied to bedrock principles, and no one's going to say no to that. That's
a
no-brainer.
I mean, they express an opinion, and then they say nothing in our expressed opinion is taking away your rights.
Actually,
so it's exactly the same thing.
Right.
It's still expressing the opinion.
They reaffirmed it in the document
right.
itself, which
yeah.
is...
So, but the opinion is still there, and there's
right.
going to be 50, you know, these people who aren't going to agree with the opinion.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's not necessarily...
I would be fine standing
that town council, if they had one, probably said, you know what? This
yeah.
is really
yeah.
good,
yeah.
But maybe you should add in... Or, I don't know if Whitefish, Montana is big enough to have a town
But I think I'd be easier standing up for us in front of folks who maybe didn't hold exactly the same opinion and were pointing to either the Constitution, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts,
yeah.
and principles they learned as children in school. And then in the modern day, we're expressing that, look, we're a diverse community. We come from, I'm the second generation of immigrants myself. My dad and my grandparents got picked on mercilessly. And we understand it. And we're very tolerant to people that come in that are different with us. I work with a number of international companies, I know all about different cultures and how they think and what they tolerate and what they don't. Not everyone has that. And these are all teachable moments. But I think now you're tying back to bedrock principles, and I think that's going to be easier for the board to kind of get behind. Does that make sense?
Yes, and they still do express an opinion in their document. So, I mean, that's what we're looking for, and adding the additional, reaffirming of the rights that we're not looking to abridge your rights. It's sort of adding that extra belt and suspenders.
As long as we talk about the rights that people are guaranteed,
yeah,
and that we'll take a harsh posture publicly to any attempt to curtail those rights.
Yeah. I mean, that's to me, I don't know if you have an opinion on that, but...
I'm perfectly fine to work that in.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is important. That's really important that people have.
We just had an aha moment, folks. I don't know if you realize that. We're in violent agreement.
I was arguing. I forget. We argue about so many things at the kitchen table. And I just kind of threw my hands up and said, you know what? You're entitled to your opinion. To myself. Mm-hmm. And he goes, I'm not entitled to my opinion. You're not entitled to your opinion. You are, however, entitled to what you can defend. And I said, oh, okay, so that's how we're going
to
do this.
You're entitled to your opinion. It's guaranteed, right?
Yeah. You're only entitled to as to what you can defend. So.
And so I'll take that back. If this was constructed in such a form, would you be interested to have a proclamation of sorts, or would you still want it to have something in a different form that you'd be still looking for individual responses?
And maybe I think you if there was a document that resembled what we had put together with the additions of these bedrock principles,
yeah,
and taking out the language about residents specifically, maybe reworking the actual language of the one paragraph, maybe taking out reject and putting in not condone, or something that feels better to people. I mean, I think it would be great if it came from you, if it's something,
yeah,
that you felt like you wanted to produce.
The other option is the board could develop its own with whatever comfort level, probably along similar levels. You guys could maintain the document you have today. We could do
right.
Something.
You know what?
Yeah.
I
to go for a parallel document.
You know what? That's just, in my feeling, too much work. A lot of it, 90% of it will probably overlap.
It's probably quicker though, Barry, because you're not going to get one document to be accepted by all groups, but you can get the ideas supported by all groups.
Let me ask you. Maybe we can go back and just talk to our drafters, you know, amongst ourselves and see.
I know there's a lot of passion on your side. And
I don't want to speak for everyone.
I understand exactly,
you know,
what you're talking about.
So maybe we can sort of...
And I'm happy to work. I mean, if you want... You know, participation from one of us. I'm happy to kind of work with you on it, as you know, as a contributor, not as a, you know,
vetter.
A vetter or a police on it. I mean, I'm happy to do that if you think.
But if the other option is we just come out with a complimentary document that's kind of more in our comfort zone, that kind of sticks more to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you're right.
Yeah.
That is an option too.
And I'm getting the sense today,
yeah,
that's probably okay as an option. I'm not saying we'd get on it, but...
I think that is totally an option.
Yeah.
Okay, so next steps.
Well, just before, Kate, before you...
Yeah.
So if we did sort of a dual thing, so we have these two documents, you know, what are we gonna do with them? I mean,
They're proclamations. They're just expressions of thought. They don't have to reconcile.
We were talking about, I was kind of thinking about, well, if it's a form of a resolution or a proclamation, you know, is it something that you're going to go to the school committee and ask them to sign? Is it something that ultimately you might go to town meeting? And
yeah.
Have
oh,
town
yeah.
meeting endorse
yeah.
this?
Mm-hmm.
So that it's
yep.
kind of
that.
Not just the Board of Selectmen doing, you know, a proclamation for, you know, the Eagle Scouts.
Actually, when we first came in here, that was my first thought, was that this almost sounds like an instructional motion. For a group to
yes.
get together to work that.
Right, and the instructional
and
motion, right, it sounds like it already voted, and we're doing what the instructional
yeah.
motion would have
yeah.
said for us to
yeah.
have done, which is
thank
to
you.
Get together and work on that. I like the idea of a single document that we can all kind of stand by.
If you can do, just do me a favor so that we can sort of talk and figure out. I mean, because we do have 200 and whatever people who signed on to this, and so I want to be respectful of that, and so I just want to have an offline conversation.
I get it entirely.
Yeah.
I think most people though would be of the people who signed this would be jazzed that you guys got this far.
Yeah. No, I agree, and I don't want to diminish what's happening because I think it's to have the buy-in of my leaders is
important.
What our goal was for this whole thing.
Right.
So I don't want to diminish that at all.
Well, it might be still success to have a document that's in a different voice but is complementary. That way there's a document, we're standing behind those words, they're 70-80% overlap with the concepts in yours. Where there's differences, we can explain them and be comfortable with them. I know, Barry, you're shaking your head. But I do think that's one path. That leaves you the independence to stay
with
you.
Our action could be just changing our policy. I mean, our policies are not open. I mean, they can come and sit at the meeting and say, well, I think your policies are open. But if we, I think our proclamation should be is that, you know, we think this is a great idea, and now we're going to work it into the policies of the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah, but
and
what
that's our action.
That's great. And then the next 300 people show up and say, let's do something different. And the next 300 people show up. If you go back to the original black letter, you don't have to worry about that because you're tying back to established.
What would be the purpose of having two documents?
He wants to give us the autonomy.
It gives you the independence to stay where you are and use your own language and not accept any edits from any group, and you can say whatever you want, as you already have. And at the same time, you can get complementary. It's almost a concurring view from a different body. It might be in their own tongue. It might be in their own phrasing.
Are we, in that case, would you guys still be seeking endorsement from Board of Selectmen?
Our response to that would be, here's our statement or here's our proclamation to that effect.
I just think it's more powerful if we speak with one voice.
I am with
and
you,
just, and agree, and work and just... Let's create a document that...
But then you have to do it again with the school committee. And then you have to do it again with the police chief. And if you're autonomous, you don't have to do that.
Right. You don't need
if
anyone's
guys,
approval.
I mean, if there's
this.
A document that you sign on to, I think that... I mean, the police chief said directly that he couldn't do anything until you did. But there are so many towns that have joint statements from the police chief and the town.
Yeah.
There's these freedom teams that are happening and all these...
Maybe I'm crazy, but I take this stuff incredibly seriously. If it comes out of my mouth, it's going to be words and phrases.
And again, endorsed or authored, like different?
Independently.
Sure.
If I'm going to endorse
and
it.
And to that end, each board member has a vote.
If
you
it's
know?
A proclamation, we've never had anything but a 5-0 statement on a proclamation, and I hesitate to have anything but a 5-0. Well, but the point here is to avoid the controversy. We're trying to iron out
which
this, right?
Kind of,
to a point. I mean, I'm not looking for a document that is so wordsmithed to become acceptable to 100% of people that it essentially says nothing at all.
Nor am I. I'm not trying to make this be a sanitary document.
Yeah.
The thing about the challenge, I mean, just the very nature of having these kind of discussions during this time is that it's designed to make people uncomfortable, right? It's designed to kind of make people think about things that maybe they didn't think about before or didn't realize maybe an issue that, you know, is affecting neighbors of mine.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if it was so kind of, if it was so like, oh, yeah, everyone would agree with that, then I don't know how much new ground we may have broken.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not saying we have to hit people over the head with anything. I'm certainly not. And I think that there's a lot of work that could be done to the, you know, to this document to make it, you know, sound better and also kind of deal with the issues of First Amendment issues, deal with the issues of kind of, you know, is this a gender? I think this could be done better, but the overall framework, I think, is there. And I really like, I mean, what is it, Whitefish, Montana?
Mm-hmm.
I think that was a powerful... You know, a powerful statement, succinct. I think we could work it into something like this, and have everybody say, yeah, you know what, I can buy into that. And now there's one document that the town of Reading is going to stand behind.
But your group may not like the edits that come out of that. You may find that that's
right.
That's been
absolutely
too intrusive.
Yeah.
And so,
and if that's the case, then then maybe that's the default thing that we'll do. But I think in the meantime, let's try to work on one document. And if we can't, right, if it's just we get to the point where good effort and good faith have been put in, and, you know, these guys want to do something else, we're uncomfortable, or vice versa, then we can always resort to that.
I guess it all comes down to schedule. So obviously we've kind of broken ground here tonight. This is only the first step in many more. So
one thing that after reading this document online, the first
I'm not doing a good job on minutes.
The first thing that when I read it all, it is almost like reading some of the Riot Act in a way, whereas this. In other words, you're coming out and you're saying, well, we think this is the right way to deal with that. We think that's the right way to do that. The first reaction people get is, who are you to tell me how I should react to anything?
No, well, that's the first reaction of some people, but other people
had tears in their
were
eyes.
So enthused. So it's not everyone's reaction.
Yeah, it isn't, but a lot of people do have that reaction because their first response is, it's a little offensive how you're saying this.
There's a presumption that's...
that something is wrong or someone has done something wrong and you're trying to correct them or be peremptory or be, you know, we know you didn't say the right thing to your neighbor and we don't approve of that. It's very negative. It comes across very negative. Further resolve.
Words we got from... looking at what other communities used as a format. I mean, I'm not married to the whereas, resolved, further resolved, so I don't think anybody's tied to that.
Part of the first part.
Yeah.
Right.
You don't want to divide people, you want people
it also
to
sets
be
it up in very formal language.
Well, you want it to be more inclusive. You want people to agree.
Actually, Linda's hit it on the head. That's the whole thing we're poking at here.
You have to say, because... a lot of people are silent, and they do the most wonderful things. You would be amazed at what some people in this community and other communities do. And they do it all below the radar, and their neighbor doesn't even know what they do because they have personal conscience and conviction in what they do. And they do more than all of us.
Oh, absolutely.
So when someone else comes along, newbies to the town, where people have been for a long time, there's an automatic, oh, someone doesn't know that we love each other, that we care for each other, that we check on shut-ins, that we do these favors for our neighbors. We've been doing it. Welcome to our community. Join us in serving others, not just writing something, doing it.
Linda, I wouldn't put this as a sort of folks who've been here for a while versus folks who've moved here.
No, but it's
kind of thing.
That's how it's set up. I come from another community and they supported this. I don't care what another community does. I care about my neighbors and my friends in Reading, whether they're doing okay, whether they need help, whether I can help them make a meal, whether someone is comfortable or uncomfortable as a new person in my neighborhood.
And our reference to other communities was more to the point where other communities were okay, their leadership was okay with condemning.
Well,
and I think that's what
they
we
have
were looking
that in
to.
Their community, and they feel like this is the public push to address something
but
that's been
it,
simmering
does it
below
take
the
something
surface.
Bad happening, though, for us to make this language palatable?
Even if something bad happens, this language isn't going to help. One thing.
I mean, I think we're
I
sort
mean,
of.
Someone may
comes back
feel,
to the negative versus the positive.
Someone may feel good that someone signed this document. This doesn't do anything for a lot of people.
I think, and it's not going to do anything for a lot of people because the fact is, most people in Reading are not going to be impacted by this at all. Most people in Reading go about their day, their week, and their month, and they never encounter bigotry. And so for those people, this seems unnecessary.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But for the minority who we are trying to stand up for, this is daily.
Daily.
That they live with this. So it's hard for other people who don't live with it to grasp, I think. And it does seem like, well, I'm a good person and my neighbors are good people. and we're good to each other. We don't need this. And I am so happy that most people in our town don't need this. This is for the minority. This is for the people who are vulnerable in our community, and they exist. And this is for them. And that's enough for me. That's enough to know that 4%, I don't know the numbers. I don't know the demographics. I don't know how many Jewish people we have here. I don't know how many Muslims. I don't know how many people of color.
We don't count.
It's we don't. But it's fair to say that it's small. And if this document can make them feel more welcome in our community, that's enough for me.
And I think, you know, we were talking earlier and I was sharing about my friend, and you had a lovely sentiment, and you said, I'll have her over for tea and tell her she doesn't need to be afraid. And that is a lovely sentiment. And I've said that to her personally, but telling someone they don't need to be afraid versus, like, one-on-one versus you can't talk someone out of what they're seeing in their nation. Like, you can't talk them out of that.
No, but you can explain it to them in a way that they can understand.
And this is an effort at that.
You know, a lot of people feel their feelings are based on what they know and their personal experience, whereas other people just go out with feelers and feelings all the time, and it's not necessarily related to any reality.
Well, I think I understand what you're saying. You're saying some people might read this and say, oh, someone's browbeating me into acting, you know, being a better person. I don't need anybody telling me I'm a better person.
No, not that. I think it's just a little bit, I don't want to say
I think the concern, one of the concerns that a lot of people have when you coin words like hate speech and indifference, okay, you're getting into motives in a person's heart. I love debate, okay, friendly debate. I liked it when I was in school, I liked to seek out the students I disagreed with, and we became good friends, but we'd debate. I had a conversation with a Muslim friend. My sister-in-law was married to a Sunni Muslim from Egypt. When I said, no, we don't believe Muhammad is a prophet, okay, that was hate speech to him. And this is what I mean when I say, when you get too specific in your statement, and this is where I would ask you, selectmen, to not be too definitive, okay, for anything you come up with in the way of a resolution, you got to be careful because so many things are subject to interpretation. And really, again, I'm convinced that creation is destructive to people's evolution is destructive to people's lives. But see, a lot of you, if you don't believe that it's wrong to teach, and I'm using this because I think it's a valid example. If you don't think it's wrong to teach evolution as fact, there's a glaring example of intolerance because it is, with my tax dollars, a paid policy as far as education goes. And so what I'm saying is, this kind of language, I think, is only going to empower people, some of whom I disagree with, to be even more zealous in their discrimination against my point of view, to the point where they enact public policy. And that's a fear. Do you see where I'm coming from? That's a fear some of us have. With all your well-meaning concern about diversity and minorities and all the rest, I'd match a point-to-point, relationship-to-relationship, you know, with my high regard for people of different point of view, okay? But I'm just saying that a lot of this language leads to policy that's discriminatory, and I feel that. I've been in a minority point of view where I've been discriminated because of my beliefs. Only your tax dollars and mine get to go and advance an agenda that happens to be more popular. So, you know.
Let's do a quick check.
Can I just read one thing into the, I know we're audio recording it, and I thought it was.
I hope it comes out.
I found it very illustrative of exactly the dichotomy that we're talking about in terms of prohibiting versus not condoning. I just wanted to read it so that people understood.
Where'd you get this from?
This is from the findings. It's the City University of New York, which is a state actor. It's the rules are similar, which is why I pulled it. They have the same First Amendment obligations as a state
You
actor.
You had something similar on when they do, someone was putting up the Nazi posters.
Yeah.
and UMass.
Well, I might disagree with that because I think I'm much more of a libertarian than you all give me credit for. But these are findings from a former federal prosecutor and a former Manhattan federal judge that Cooney had asked to give an opinion, a legal opinion, about things that were happening on campus. It was mostly anti-Semitic speech on campus. There had been several issues. And the college, the state actor, wanted to understand what their obligations were to their students and what their obligations were to, as a state actor, what they could and couldn't do.
Right.
And so I found it interesting and illustrative. The report found that much of the offensive speech, even if featured at die-ins, mock checkpoints, student signs and banners, was protected under the First Amendment. As a public university, the college is limited in the ways that it can respond to hate speech, whether the words are anti-Semitic, racist, anti-Muslim, or anti-LGBT. The college cannot punish such speech unless it is part of a course of conduct so pervasive or severe that it denies a person's ability to pursue an education or participate in university life. It cannot mandate civility or sanction isolated derogatory comments. But what the college cannot punish, it can still condemn. They noted that as a general rule, the college administrators and college presidents have spoken out against anti-Semitic comments. That practice must continue. Hate speech must be challenged promptly and forcefully, lest it breed. So for me, that was a good summary of the differences from two prominent.
I'm with that up until the words hate speech. The anti-Semitic is such a... the Jews have been persecuted for 6,000 years?
6,001. Kept this year.
So that's almost a brand identity to say it badly by itself, and that's. But it's the overuse of the word hate speech. I think you can talk about a legally protected speech, but I like the construction of that to say we can't condemn it,
right?
We can't prevent it. We can't.
No.
It was almost kind of like sort of what Trump was saying in his first line of speech the other night.
I didn't know.
He opened with that, right?
The thing about, you might disagree on it.
Right.
But,
So that's the legal, there's the political as well. And that's the thing
mm-hmm.
Barry and I would be interested in, is not trying to offend too many voters.
Yep.
Because we need a few of them now and then.
Yep.
Right.
And that's not something we have to worry about. So that's why that's in your court.
We know we've done a good job.
So can we speak offline as drafters? And
can you send me a copy of that? That's actually
this
great.
One?
Or can
yeah.
I just take a picture of it?
Yeah.
Did you give it back to John Casey?
Sure.
Did you get back the piece of paper?
Yes, thank you. It came back.
Did you get it back?
It came back.
Yeah, I guess.
So much easier to just take pictures now.
Yeah.
So was that a, that was not a court case. That was more of a sought out opinion.
It was an opinion letter.
For the school, because it's a public college.
So before they,
it's guidance.
Right, before they took any action, they wanted to kind of
know what their parameters were.
It's their
yeah.
counsel's
yeah.
opinion.
Right.
So here's an interesting point. Let's say, had they not done this, and let's say, there was some really vile kind of stuff, and the city college expelled a student.
Mm-hmm.
They could be open to a lawsuit from
right.
that student.
Unless it was
mm-hmm.
continuing behavior.
Or unless, that those actions, put someone else in physical danger or prohibited them from enjoying their rights.
Right, or if some of it was graffiti stuff, and I'm sure that they have, they dealt with that in the way
right.
that was appropriate.
Right.
So, anyway, the First Amendment is fascinating.
Is
it's wonderful.
Quick time check here. We're at 9:30.
Yeah.
I can continue to go if you folks want to, or we can call it a night and reschedule. We can have a follow-up meeting. You got some work to do already.
Yeah, I think that this is a good point to talk about next steps.
Yeah.
So let's talk about schedule, first of all.
Yeah.
What's today? Today is Monday. I can support meetings later on in the week. I'm not sure what your schedule is. You said you were out, right?
Next week I'm out.
But this week, like Thursday, Friday?
Friday I'm out of town. Thursday night, probably not great, only because...
Actually, I take that back. I've got conference calls Thursday night with Singapore and Wednesday night with China, I think. I could do Friday night. I know that's a crummy night. It's a family night.
Yeah, I'm going to be out of town.
Tomorrow night is our meeting. Wednesday night is probably just too quick.
Could you do something over the weekend potentially? Is that a possibility, or you folks would rather just keep it evenings for family? And
what's the schedule for next?
We could do
Monday.
A,
you said you
Monday.
Were
I'm
not,
I've got a meeting.
Right?
I'm committed to Tuesday. Tuesday's open next week, not this week.
Is
next week.
Yeah, I'm out of town from Tuesday through the weekend. I'm on vacation.
But I think it would be useful to have something. Maybe we don't have to meet. Maybe we can take it offline. Can we do email communication with two?
You
is
can
that,
do anything you want. You're private
open?
Citizens. My question is: this
I mean,
is
can
a,
you respond
no, with,
with?
Yeah,
we're subject to open meeting law, so everything here is subject to open meeting law. We'll post the minutes. We'll post the audio. We need quorum. What are the other?
But
issues?
How does that work with like online communication?
You
know, like say we meet over the next couple of days.
You
do we
separately?
Have to? Yeah.
No, you can do whatever you want.
No. But then.
No, but this
do
subgroup.
Do we need to meet
you
in
three
a group
persons.
To
you three, you,
talk to you,
yes.
Or can we talk over email or?
You can call us on the phone. You can't have a group meeting by email, as a subgroup. But open meeting law says it's got to be conversations and deliberations have to be open to the public. Other than questions like when are we meeting or I can't make it Tuesday night or something
yeah, sure.
like that. But deliberations happen in a public in a forum where the public can see it.
Even
so,
when there's only two of us?
If you don't have quorum, you don't have a meeting. So if we don't have quorum, which in this group would be three of them, two of us, 50% means a quorum is three or more.
Oh, because we're officially on a subgroup.
You are
or something.
This is a subgroup subject to open meeting law.
Okay.
We're happy to have other members of the public, but the quorum is us five. So
actually,
all the
I don't think I'm in.
You're not. So minutes
so
are...
Demetrius is technically
in. Demetrius. So she's not here tonight, but we still have quorum. So our minutes and attendance will be taken. All meetings are open to the public. We need a 48-hour minimum notice for any meeting that we have. It has to happen in a public building. I'll make a recording because I think it's more appropriate because you can't capture every little nuance.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to develop something, and then it'll go to the town manager and town council as well as the other... Board of Selectmen members, and then this group will determine the content of a proclamation, if that's the way you want to go, or if there isn't, we can develop a parallel document.
I think that's the way that we can leave it now, and then we can circle
so
back.
For what these guys want to do with the resolution after it leaves the Board of Selectmen, that's not really up to us, right? I mean, they
can take it further, they can.
Right, so it's not... You know, the charge to this group is basically the two of us to work with them to come up with, a workable document. What they do with it after us, that's a different...
Yeah, that document is frozen.
They can go to another town and sell the idea to them if they want.
I think you've got a lot of support on the board for civility, lawful behavior, supportive individuals. Linda's talked about there's a lot of stuff going at the private level. We're very active through our church in terms of doing outreach and meals ministry and helping folks that don't have a dime to spare. We have a clothing closet, so we do quite a bit, and a lot of that doesn't get recorded.
Because you don't want to lose
your heavenly rewards.
I don't think the purpose of this document is to shame us into just being better citizens.
No, but I think it's to call attention to folks that, right now more than... Right now, we should all be mindful of everyone's civil rights and everyone's civil liberties. And somehow that's a balance that's hard to, as that University of New York document describes, sometimes it's hard to stomach.
Yeah, but there are people, I mean, we're all doing God's work here on earth in one form or another. At least I hope so.
Some are doing it worse than others,
yeah.
That's all.
But I think the sort of gist of where this is not so much, well, we're going to try to take care of each other. I think that there are people who fear, who are basically living in fear,
mm-hmm.
that they're coming for me, or I'm on the menu. And while there might not be direct incidents here in Reading, I think the purpose of this is to bring attention to that, and hopefully deter those kinds of things, or let everybody know that as a community, we don't stand for that. Kind of stuff, and we will be supportive of people who are in the minority.
We are supportive. You don't have to put it in the future.
Oh, but I mean, it's sort of as
this
a,
is
as a,
the community we are. This
right.
is why people want to live here.
Then really, this is then it's not a resolution. It's a reaffirmation.
Yes. Yeah, I was going to say that.
Of what?
What we already do.
You know, what goes on other places, you know, this is not our town. And that's how I kind of look at it.
Somewhere in the middle here, there's a solution. I know we keep swirling around this, and we talk to data from different perspectives. There's a way out of this.
I just want to just make sure we're on the same page on the minutes, because I think it was left as that they're okay with two documents.
There'll be one set of minutes that I'll submit. You're happy to take your own notes. There's an audio recording, and that's probably the best of all, because you've got tone, you've got Q&A.
But is there... I mean, is that okay to go back to the minutes and just make sure that
I actually didn't read them as we were going.
Well, we've covered a lot of ground here. So
no, it was just that one statement. It was because I was unsure. Because right. I thought we had changed it. Group would be okay with an independent statement by the board that was complimentary.
Or there's two paths that you're considering right now.
Got it. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. All right. Good.
Mm-hmm.
And then Linda mentioned how do we make the phrasing more inclusive? The outside parties might perceive it as inhibiting versus supportive. I can get rid of this.
Thank you. That's helpful.
So this is really short, and there's a lot that I'm glossing over, but this is...
So are you going to send those to all of us? Or
I will send it to all of you. The file and the audio is pretty small. No, I can't email that. It's too big. I can put it on Google Drive and distribute it that way, but let me talk to the town manager and town council.
Myself talk.
How are these audio minutes posted?
I don't know yet. I got to figure that out. I just thought I'd capture them.
Yeah.
That's the most important. We can ask tomorrow night.
So we did not agree on another. We didn't agree on another time.
So it sounds like there's nothing this week that makes sense. How about the weekend?
I could potentially do, but it may be too quick. I mean, tomorrow night obviously is our meeting.
Well, they said they had to go back.
They
needed some time.
Right. Wednesday, don't have anything. Thursday, I potentially could do, although I'm out of, you know, it's my. I could potentially do Thursday, but then I'm out for another week. So
I want to make sure that when town council has his thoughts on the resolution ready, that we're able to look at those, because I think it'll inform whatever language we might be changing. For example, if he came back and said, oh yeah, I didn't know that was a resolution. I was talking about policy. Like, if it's a resolution, you guys can do whatever you want. I think that might change the sort of lens maybe that we're looking at.
I guess. There's a political lens and a legal lens.
Yeah.
I'd like to get through both of them.
Yeah.
He doesn't want us to get sued.
No, absolutely.
And I'd like to stay elected, so.
So I think, at least for me, for a working group, I think that information will be very informative.
So what I actually will send him this and ask him if construction, let me think through that, whether that makes sense.
Because I think he has the document. I think that Bob sent him the resolution after the last meeting and asked... I think maybe I can confirm with Bob.
Right.
I think the ask is already there, but he's out of town.
The other thing we can do tomorrow night is ask the board what their sentiments are in terms of doing something that's parallel but different.
I mean, we're going to, just so you know, we're going to report to the board, so as part of our regular liaison. It will probably prompt discussion knowing our group. That could be.
It'll be short. It'll be
during
the open session.
I think the board is sort of relying on the two of us to kind of come back when it's done.
Yeah.
Although they're periodic check-ins, I'm sure.
We can give them progress statements.
You know.
But look, the takeaway here tonight is we had a bad first date, right? And the second date's not so bad, right? So let's figure out how to get to the third date. Maybe the dating analogy falls apart after that, so.
So I think... our citizens group.
And are you saying the five of you or the whole 200 and...
No, the drafters.
How many,
I call
the
us
drafters.
The drafters.
How many draft? Are there five drafters?
Yeah.
We need to decide for ourselves what we're willing to work with, right? What we're willing to add or take out. In the meantime, I think town council's getting back from vacation in the middle of the week, right? At sure Bob said the like the 8th or the 9th. 9th,
I think, yeah.
And then...
But again, that's the legal lens.
That's, right, but still an important lens.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, it would be nice if we could get back together after town council. Can put in his 2 cents.
So that puts you into next week then?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I'm just going to be...
No, I know. I mean...
From the 14th to the 19th.
Okay.
Do we have to defer our next meeting until you return?
You certainly could. I mean, I don't have to. I mean, I would like to be here.
Yeah.
But if you feel that there's, you know, if you've gotten, you know, feedback from the group and, and you want to kind of move ahead and have some ideas, I mean, I can certainly.
Do you want to try meeting on Sunday? Can you meet on Sunday afternoon? I'm busy Sunday morning.
No, I'm going to be in, I'm Saturday? Out of town twice.
Saturday. Still?
I'll be in Long Island. So I'm home for one day.
It's Friday, and that day is what?
Monday the 13th.
And then you're gone out till the 17th?
To the 19th.
To the 19th. So that actually takes
Ohio,
you into the next week.
Home, do my laundry, go to
Okay. So I've got 2 big conference calls on Wednesday and Thursday of this week. I could do Friday anytime over the weekend. And Monday I've got a meeting. Tuesday we don't have. Why don't we meet on the 14th? If no other reason, I know it's not a Board of Selectmen meeting. Tuesday the 14th.
Okay. Well, what about Friday?
Friday the.
The 10th.
He's out of town.
Oh, you're leaving in the morning. Sorry, I missed that. Okay.
So if we want Barry there, it's got to be the week of the 20th. That's what I'm putting together.
Unless
Monday the
13th,
if you want to grab me. So I'll be home for a day.
Do you want to do it not in the evening?
I can't.
The 13th?
I'm tied up on the 13th evening.
In the morning?
I can actually meet. I can't
do anything in the morning on the 13th.
Is there a time during these that are business and not pleasure where you could do a conference? I don't want to do a pleasure time.
Can you do remote participation?
You can ask Mrs. Berman, but my guess is probably it'd be. No, because in the evenings, we're going to do it. I would say that would be tough to commit to.
So let's turn our attention then to the week of the 20th. So that means there's a Board of Selectmen meeting on the 21st. So that's out. Monday might be open. You're out the Monday the 20th also?
No, I'm back.
So that's a potential, two weeks from tonight.
I know your schedule as well as you. I can speak to
you. All right. And Kenzie, I don't want to start drawing this out, you know. I'd like to keep up the momentum with this. So could we meet sooner without word from town council?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yep.
I can do Thursday.
And maybe we have to have, if town council says this, then this. If town council says this, then this. You know, like
choose your own adventure.
Yeah, I mean, he's either going to say one of two things.
Right.
I could meet this Thursday. I don't know if that gives you enough time to go back to your group and kind of get a feel for what you want
to do. Yeah, I think that's fine. Yeah.
Thursday night I have a conference call, so I wouldn't be able to meet until later in the evening, probably until Thursday nights with. It's an evening call,
or even in the morning.
I could probably do something on Thursday afternoon. Does that work? Oh wait, you're out.
No, I mean I'm in Boston, but so best times for me are kind of like before school and 7:30, 8 o'clock, and then again in the evening. I can maybe do it like. Maybe 5 o'clock or something like that, because I'm heading out of town the next day, so I've got to prepare. But, or even, if the evening doesn't work, maybe 5 o'clock or breakfast.
Yeah. For Thursday, is it?
Yeah. Friday might do.
How is there a way to do some work on this offline? What level
you can do,
of
you guys
work?
Can do whatever you want, but as a group, we can't deliberate.
We can send you emails. You can think about them. Can you respond to just one person? Can you respond to nobody?
You can distribute minutes, but generally open meeting law says there's no deliberation. There's no continued thought process that the public can't see. This is a public
meeting. How inefficient is this, right?
That's
this
what I meant,
crazy.
How crazy government
this
is. But this is, but it's for a reason, so the public can, in theory,
right.
influence it. Now, we're not crowded tonight, but I could imagine that it won't be the case always.
John, what time should conference call in on Thursday?
Let me go find it. I didn't have it posted yet. I think it's the guys from...
I have a Singapore client, too. I got a call at 5 in the morning.
It's Scott did this.
10-7?
Scott Segura, that's it. Sorry, it's not Singapore, it's Malaysia. Let me see if Thursday happens. I got to call him back. If I can push that off for another day, then my Thursday night would open up. Let me see if I can
do that. We should probably just ask Paula to post us.
Yes, let's do it provisionally. I'll ask her to do that. All right, let me add that to the minutes. Post next meeting.
And that will give you guys time to kind of figure out stuff.
Is Thursday.
Would you send me that Whitefish, Montana? Mm-hmm.
6, 7, 8, 9.
I don't know. They may be off the beaten path.
Just take a picture of it. John will ask for Paula to post. All right. Thank you all.
Does anybody have any parting thoughts or?
Team.
Yeah. Motion to adjourn.
Thanks.
All those
Thank
in
you.
Favor?
Oh.
4-0.
Sorry, I forgot I was a voting member
yeah.
of this.
At 9:40.
Bye, everyone.
Good
Bye,
night.
Bye, Teresa. Thank you. Barry, it's going to go to Comcast because that's the only one I have in here.
That's fine.
Okay.
That's the one I use for
okay.
work stuff.
While I have you, I wanted to put a thought, and you can tell me it stinks. It's fine. But one of the things I do in our business is we often have disparate groups that have usually very different opinions, and we try to bring them together. Usually it's employees, or it might be constituencies that can't agree. We go through a process we call language processing. I don't think we need it, but it's got some interesting thoughts. We take yellow stickies, maybe you've done this yourself, and you distribute them. And everyone puts an idea that they want the final document to have in it. It could be a sentence, it could be a word. And you take as many as you want. It could be 100, it could be 5, it could be 10. Barry does some, I do some, you do some, blah, blah, blah. We then put them all on the whiteboard. One by one, we group them. I might have an idea that matches yours. I might have an idea that's unique. And you end up with groups of ideas, and they're all around a common theme. So you might have 50 stickies that talk about liberty, and you might have one sticky that talks about condemn. I'm making this up now, obviously. And then you put on top of that an umbrella document that says all of these things are really one thought. They're repetitions of a thought. They're all one thought, and that high-level thought is X. And then by putting X in there, and you have a bunch of different examples of those, you've captured all of the constituent thoughts in the document. I don't think we need to do that. But it's one way that I thought tonight I came prepared to do it. We might get to recasting an entirely different document if it came to that around ideas and get the ideas on the table. Forget the construction. Forget the rest of the articles of speech. And just get the ideas on the board and then group them. It could be as expansive as we wanted. It could include people that weren't even in the room. I mean, weren't even in the group. We don't have to do it, and we're not going to do it tonight, obviously, but I thought I'd throw it out as a way to kind of, it's one of the ways I use to get the yes around groups that have disparate opinions. All right.
And. my impression, the actual subgroup working group has closer or tighter connection and less disparate opinion.
Well, you've kind of already gotten buy-in, right? They've already kind of, you know, sent a petition in.
No, I mean, for instance, the subgroup, the official subgroup that we have, I think has less disparate.
You're closer together than you thought.
Whatever the voting members are of this triumvirate.
All right, I'm going to stop recording because we're a little bit past the meeting. So let's see if this works. Let's